Hi, and welcome here to the Homestead on the Hill. In this video, we're doing the final installation of these, our wireless power receivers. You see, we're getting our electricity from our closest nuclear fusion reactor, which is located about 93 million miles that away. If you are new here, my name is Hein, and my wife and I are building a tiny house and a homestead on a bare piece of land all by ourselves. Up to now, our solar panels were simply deployed flat on the ground, which in retrospect was not the greatest idea. We had some field mice nesting under some of these panels, and our 50 kilogram Rottweiler, that's 110 pounds, tried to get to one of them, in the process completely destroying one of the panels. When we relocated from the city to the farm, we brought our solar system with us. I had 12 of these 330 watt panels. But with one of them being broken, I'm only going to mount 10 of them on the solar stand, because 11 just doesn't fit properly and I like symmetry. To build the stand for the solar panels, it was back to digging holes, an activity that I had not engaged in for some time. I will admit that I was somewhat out of shape. The position of the solar stand is also not negotiable, as I will be enclosing the sides of the stand to form a storage shed slash workshop. And I want the shed to cover and protect the septic tank, but still provide access to the tank if necessary. In between all the digging, there was some time for a bit of fun with Oberon. The positions of the holes turned out to be in some of the hardest ground we have dug so far. The digging of 6 holes took us over a week, as we had 2 rainy days in the middle of the digging. This specific hole, the worst of the lot, is maybe 6 inches deep, and that's after 1 solid hour of digging. With the rocky ground, the only solution without power tools like a jackhammer is to use a crowbar, or a kufut in my mother tongue, also known as a gwala in South Africa. Eventually, all 6 holes were completed, and we could start planting the poles. We leave a layer of gravel around the base of the wooden pole to assist with water drainage, and cast a collar of concrete around the pole. With the holes around 2 feet deep in this hard and rocky ground, these poles, once planted, will stay planted. We also left the poles alone for a few days for the concrete to cure before starting work on the structure. I would like to take this opportunity to thank and welcome all the new subscribers. I read all your comments and really appreciate your input. If you find our channel interesting and would like to follow our progress, please consider subscribing. The solar panels will be mounted at an inclination of 30 degrees, as we are at approximately 30 degrees south latitude. The panels are also oriented to point straight north. To achieve the 30 degrees angle, the front poles are cut off level, shorter than the rear poles, which are also cut level. A string level was sufficient to level out the tops, and again, due to the slope of our ground, the lengths are quite deceptive. It looks wrong, but it is level. Here we have all the poles cut to length, ready for the next phase of construction. As with the foundation poles of the house, I am notching the top of the poles to provide for a secure mount of the front and back beams, which are fastened to the poles with a threaded rod and nuts. I believe in America this threaded rod is known as all thread. This is what the front and rear beams look like, ready for the installation of the panel support rafters. All the wood is treated with a wood preservative product before final mounting. And with all the panel supports installed, I mounted the solar panels. Initially, I planned on mounting the panels horizontally, four stacked above each other and three wide. This is what the stand was designed for, and for that I would have needed only six panel support beams. But with the one panel broken during the build, I decided to mount the panels vertically. This means only two panels rest on two support beams, putting much less strain on the beams. However, I had to visit the sawmill again to get more support beams before I could mount the rest of the panels. These panels also form the roof of the shed I am planning, so I used clear silicone between the panels to seal against rainwater leaking in. The mounting of the last four panels went much quicker than the first ones, as the stand is much closer to the ground on this side, and having done it before, we found it much easier the second time around. After all the panels were mounted, all that remained was to wire up the panels and run two cables to the inverter in the house. The inverter has two independent maximum power point tracking chargers, and I run the 10 panels in two strings of 5 panels each. I used crimp terminals instead of the quick-release solar terminals the panels came with, as I do not want the excess wire as slack under the panels. A handful of zip ties to finish up and neaten the cabling, and we are seeing by far the highest efficiency of our solar panels we've ever had. Well, this is it for this video. Please leave a comment if you have any thoughts on this build. See you next time, hopefully soon, as we have more progress to share.